Hi, everybody. Thank you for coming to our virtual event hosted by CLAIM, the Center for Language, Music, and Emotion. And it's a great pleasure today to again host Stefan Litwin from Berlin, Saarbrücken, Switzerland, Mexico, an international creature, if there ever was one. He's going to give us a lecture recital, New Music and New Listening, which with a very special guest, which you've seen on the announcement with some interviews that he's had over the years with Nuria Schoenberg-Nono. At the end, we'll have an opportunity to ask some questions if you like. Please sit back, enjoy the show, and welcome to this event hosted by CLAIM. Thank you.
Schumann's Träumerei is no deviation whatsoever from the usual. It is tender, intimate, indeed, it is German. With a melody like that, you float completely in the air. One can only recognize its quality, not demonstrate it. There is no agreement to be reached on it intellectually. One understands oneself in the delight felt by it or not. Whoever cannot participate in it, no arguments can be put forward against him, and there is nothing to be said against his attacks, but to play the melody and say, how beautiful. Good evening or good day if you're watching from the United States or elsewhere on that continent. What you just heard me recite was a text by the German composer Hans Pfitzner, who in 1920 countered, or polemicized rather, against the New Vienna School, against Schoenberg and his students, in a polemical article called Die neue Ästhetik der musikalischen Impotenz, ein Verwesungssymptom. So the new aesthetic of musical impotence, a symptom of decay. Alban Berg, one of Schoenberg's most prominent students, countered with an essay called The Musical Impotence of Hans Pfitzner's New Aesthetics, and demonstrated that the Träumerei by Schumann is actually indeed beautiful, but that you can analytically show why it is beautiful. Now, in the background, you heard a performance of the Träumerei, the way it is generally played. This is a very famous recording I used with a very famous pianist. If you take a look at the score, however, you see that there is something written on top of the page, which we musicians should take heed of, which is the metronome markings. And the metronome markings by Schumann suggest a much faster tempo than what you had heard. Let me play you how this piece would sound if you were to perform it the way Schumann asks. Thank you. Of course, in the first performance we heard, Hans Pfitzner's dictum that you should just listen to the melody and say how beautiful it is would certainly apply. In the performance I did, you would listen more to the structure of the work, to the way the various phrases relate to one another. And this is really the root of the problem when we talk about listening and new listening. New listening is listening structurally, and this comes from a demand that composers in the 20th century specifically placed on the listener, that new music requires new listening. And no composer is more prominent for this demand than Arnold Schoenberg. Arnold Schoenberg revolutionized music more than anybody else. His shift from tonal music to non-tonal music is really paradigmatic. And it happened at a historical time when societies were shifting as well. It's not a coincidence that Schoenberg's move to pantonality, as he would have referred to it, the liquidation of tonality, happens at a time basically where the Habsburg monarchy is crumbling. So in a way, the liquidation of tonality anticipates the liquidation of the monarchy. Let us take a look specifically at the very first piano pieces that execute this liquidation of tonality. Let me play you the opening of Opus 11, number 1, which was written around 1909. So clearly, we are in a different territory. This is no longer tonal music. It's no music that is defined by cadences. So you know where you're at home, unless, of course, you would recompose the opening. If I had this opening by Schoenberg, and I would harmonize it differently, then I have a tonal piece. This, of course, is not what Schoenberg wants. Schoenberg wants to expand the musical language. And for him, dissonance and consonance, the idea of dissonance and resolution, is no longer applicable. For him, dissonances really don't exist. These are all consonances of a different order. And this goes back to Wagner's chromaticism. In the opera of Tristan and Isolde, the opening, famous opening, with this chord, we also have dissonance and resolution. But Wagner tricks us. He makes us believe that the resolution is indeed a resolution, when in fact it is a dissonance in its own. That's how it should be resolved. In a Mozart sonata, this chord would have to be resolved like this. But by the build of chromaticism over the decades, we hear differently, we listen differently. So we hear the dissonance, the tension, and are satisfied with this simple resolution. And this is the logic consequence to this is what Schoenberg does with Opus 11. This is dissonance and resolution into a different, slighter dissonance. So you see, this is a logical step from Wagner. This is not, although it was, of course, a revolution at the time, this is, of course, a step that is logical from the chromatic buildup in the late 19th century. Schoenberg was the only one to actually execute it and to allow it to be manifest in pieces. This is over 100 years. I mean, and to be exact, 111 years that this piece was composed. We already encounter a problem of original versus modern instruments. Then indeed, if you take a look at the score, there's something that Schoenberg asks for, and that is here, a third pedal with damper. Now, the Steinway, the modern Steinway on which I am playing, has three pedals as well, but doesn't have that damper pedal. It has a normal sustaining pedal and a una corda pedal, which is just a softening of the sound, and a sostenuto pedal. But the actual third pedal that Schoenberg is referring to is what in Schubert's time would have been referred to as a moderator pedal. This is a felt that goes between the strings and the hammers, and the hammers hit the strings through the felt. And of course, it's like with a string instrument or a wind instrument, a really strong dampening sound. Now, we don't have this, and I cannot, for this reason, do justice to the composition of Arnold Schoenberg. So what I did a few years ago was I went into the studio, I had a piano built that would have the sound of a Steinway and at the same time this moderator pedal. Let's listen just to that section so that you can hear what a moderator pedal sound actually appears like. Now comes the section. And gone. So you can see that the color that is introduced is an essential part of the work. And if you don't have the instrument to provide that color, you're not really doing the work justice. So this is one of the dilemmas we are faced when we perform old music or older music. It's the same dilemma that we encounter, by the way, with Schubert. Most of his piano sonatas also call for a moderator pedal, and we can't do it justice. Let's continue with Schoenberg. Now, in the second piece of the cycle, Schoenberg sort of alludes to tonality by having a fixed note at the bottom of the piano here, a pedal tone. But of course, it's not tonal in the sense that we're used to. And the static chords that we hear have a tension in them because they're dissonant, or rather because their dissonance is emancipated. Now, when Schoenberg had written these pieces, he was very eager that well-known pianists would perform them. And he approached one of the leading pianists of his generation and a composer, Ferruccio Busoni, asking him to consider performing these piano pieces. Busoni was very gracious, answered, yes, he's very interested, would like to take a look at that. So Schoenberg went ahead and sent the scores. In a lengthy exchange, eventually, Busoni confessed to Schoenberg that although he finds the second piece, the one I just played, played part of, is the most attractive to him, he felt that they don't really work as piano music, that they are indeed beautiful compositions and very original, but that as piano music, they're just simply not luxurious enough in sound. So he tells Schoenberg that he's actually taken the liberty of rewriting the second piece, making a paraphrase. And he even suggests to Schoenberg to publish his paraphrase alongside the piano piece of Schoenberg. Schoenberg says, you know, oh, how generous of you, Mr. Busoni, how very nice of you. I couldn't be more flattered, but in fact, there is a problem. I cannot allow you to publish my work together with a version that shows how I should have improved my work. So this is clearly not something that Schoenberg wants. And I want to show you what kind of things Busoni changed. So what we just had heard, and I said that it's kind of a piano setting by Schoenberg that is that builds its tension through the reduction of the chords. Because these chords are dissonant, they have a lot of tension. And it's actually the austere character which enforces this tension. Now, Busoni just doesn't understand this because his listening, his hearing, is rooted in the 19th century. So what he makes out of this is... he just repeats it in order to use a little bit more of the keyboard. Or, for instance, when Schoenberg just simply writes... Busoni writes... So he's just enlarging the use of the keyboard to make it more pianistic, and he fails really to understand what the composition is all about. The most radical example of this misunderstanding is at the very end, where Schoenberg basically has the piece just sort of end in suspension. Finished. Well, I'll play you in a moment what Busoni did, but in a hand copy that Schoenberg had, he writes on the side, "I also find the repetitions at the end of Busoni's paraphrase objectionable. My piece does not close. It just stops. One would have to have the idea that it actually continues for a long time, like the Leierkasten of Schubert's Leiermann. But here, the end is made hermetic, so to speak, first riveted, then soldered, and thirdly also glued with wax." So this is what Busoni makes of this. So, literally, a complete misunderstanding. What is novel about Schoenberg's writing is that the piece simply stops. There is no ending in the tonal, traditional sense. And Busoni reintroduces that ending by adding those notes. So, for that reason, I think we should let Schoenberg speak now, and I will play you the three piano pieces, Opus 11, in their entirety.
Thank you. So with these piano pieces, Schoenberg revolutionized
music altogether and changed the way we listen. Now, for the first time, music was possible without a tonal framework. And for this reason, because the tonal framework was abandoned, new forms of expression were possible. The philosopher Theodor Wiesengrund Adorno referred to this, of course, as a liberation from the constraints of tonality. And the possibility now had arisen to express the fears, the condition of humankind in the early 20th century. And I think this is quite indeed the case. What's interesting, though, at the same time, is that Schoenberg revolutionized music to a degree that had never been done before. And at the same time, politically, he was very conservative. He actually was a monarchist. He believed that the monarchy was the better form of society than capitalism. So here we go. We have a composer who is a revolutionary in his own field, but as a citizen, he is something else. He is a conservative. When these pieces were performed, the painter Vasily Kandinsky heard them and was startled by the fact that this music represented sort of a parallel to what he was doing as a painter. The abandonment of tonality, in that he saw equivalent to his own abstract painting, non-representational art. I mean, it's a far-fetched to say that tonality is representational and pantonality isn't, but I see the parallel that Kandinsky would have thought important. Now, Schoenberg was honored, flattered, of course. When Kandinsky heard this explosive type of music, he also mentioned that this music seemed to him like nudes of the brain. So direct, unconscious speech to us. The kinship between Kandinsky and Schoenberg went beyond just this parallel in works because, and if you take a look at this painting of Kandinsky, you see, Schoenberg himself was an extraordinary painter. And in his piano pieces, Opus 19, which we will look at in just a few moments, Schoenberg actually uses some of his experience as a painter to apply them to music. So one of the problems of musical form after tonality has been liquidated is that we don't really know when a piece is finished. You see, Busoni thought that the piece really wasn't finished, that he paraphrased, so he added an ending that really wasn't thought of by Schoenberg. And at the same time, you could argue, well, why not? Because there is no stringency in an ending without a tonal cadence. Without this final resolution, we don't know that a piece is finished. So Schoenberg sought new ways of designing form, musical form. He used texts in order to accompany the music, the text with music, and when the text is finished, then the music ends as well. This was one of the first steps he did. But at the same time, he also went to the short versions, the bagatelles, as Beethoven would have called them, aphoristic style pieces. Take a listen to the first one of Opus 19. Thank you. So Schoenberg has the piece end right here. Every piece of the Opus 19 cycle, as you see in this one as well, is exactly one page long. You can look at the piece like a painting, like a picture. You can grasp it all at once and then delve into it in detail. Let's do that with the third piano piece. I will play you the first four measures in a way that Schoenberg didn't compose it. So if you follow the score, you will have realized that I played the left hand far too loudly. He writes pianissimo, while the right hand is forte. So let's listen to what it sounds like if I play correctly. A completely different experience, of course. And if we think of the connection to the visual arts, this could be, this is one interpretation, what is loud is in the foreground, what is soft is in the background, far away. That's one way one could listen to this spatially, or we could also listen to it as a color. Remember with the moderator pedal in Piano Pieces Opus 11, color is something that is very essential to these pieces in this phase of Schoenberg's composition. So be that as it may, the listener is asked to move along with Schoenberg's invention. This is also a new phenomenon that composers demand. It begins really with Beethoven, that composers demand that listeners listen to their music the way they conceived it, rather than, as with Mozart or Haydn, for example, the composer delivers what the listener is expecting, and maybe will play around with those expectations, but in essence, deliver something that is expected. So Schoenberg's experience as a painter enters into his composition. Here we see a painting by Schoenberg, painting called Der Gedanke, and it's not far-fetched to sort of assume that this may be a representation of Schoenberg's own head, bald head, Der Gedanke, his thoughts. This is a very impressive picture of Schoenberg's. And this is a picture of Gustav Mahler. Schoenberg calls it a Vision Gustav Mahlers. And Nuria Schoenberg-Nono has told me that while this painting was made in Vienna, Schoenberg took it with him into emigration, into exile, and had it in his studio, in his working room in Los Angeles hanging. So this was a very important picture for Schoenberg, as was Gustav Mahler generally. This is a picture that Schoenberg painted of Gustav Mahler's funeral. And shortly after this funeral, Schoenberg composed the last one of the six little piano pieces, which I will perform for you now. Thank you. I think you can hear very well how the dissolution of tonality and this new language allows completely new forms of expression. This is unthinkable in tonal language. So the musical form has changed dramatically. And while I mentioned that the painting could represent a type of matrix for these six little pieces, that each piece is visible on its own page. And much speaks for it, because Schoenberg asks actually his publisher to make sure that each painting is on one page. Another way of looking at this, of course, is these are musical aphorisms. And I think the idea of the aphorism is captured beautifully in Karl Kraus's famous aphorism. There are writers who, in a mere 20 pages, already express for what I sometimes need even two lines for. So I think this is very true to Arnold Schoenberg as well. And now let me please introduce you to my dear friend Nuria Schoenberg-Nono, with whom I did two videos from my Berlin home, and with her sitting in video conference with me in Venice during Corona. So the quality of sound is to be expected not as good as it is now, where we are here at the Max Planck Institute, where I have fantastic technicians helping me. So we did this from home, a little amateurish, but I hope you enjoy the conversation.
Nuria, you were 18, I think, or 19 when your father passed away. So your memories of your father are, of course, childhood memories mainly, and as a teenager. Can you tell us a little bit about how daily life was in Los Angeles, where you grew up?
There were remnants of, you know, of our family being European.
Yes.
So that some things, you know, like European rules. But mostly my father really, once he was in the States, and especially with my younger brothers, he wanted them to grow up just like red-blooded Americans.
As real Americans, yeah.
Because now they're really changed a lot. But anyway, he wanted them not to feel different.
Yeah. Well, he, of course...
You know, after you've just left Europe because you're a Jew, and, you know what would happen to you, and everything, he didn't want any of us to get hurt.
Yeah, well, he, of course, became an American citizen.
That's something I could only understand much, much, much later.
Yeah. Do you have any memories of rehearsals at home, of your father talking about music? I mean, you once told me, of course, and I'm focusing on that, of course, that they rehearsed Pierrot Lunaire at home once.
I mean, that was an experience for me. I think I was only about 8 years old, because I think it was 1940. I mean, the recording, I think, is from...
Yes, indeed.
Yeah. And so I was very young. But I sat on the, you know, in the back of the room, and I was just, you know, really interested, and I watched and listened to what he said to Edgar Stevie Wagner, who was a great actress and someone who did the recitation part.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a worker when I hear other people rehearsing or I hear the word played, I feel that I really know how he wanted it. And that's amazing, because I didn't hear very many rehearsals in Los Angeles or even performances. But there, I spent days listening to him tell them what he wanted and how the, you know, how the sounds were supposed to move from one instrument to the other.
Now, for our viewers and listeners, it would be very interesting also to get some background about your father's development, of course, as a young composer. These are the years that you, of course, were not yet born. But in what sense do you think painting, which your father did in his early years quite a bit, in what sense do you feel that the painting played an important role for his development? And also in terms of his musical output.
I think that's a very good connection you're making, because especially in that period, 1910.
Yes.
He was painting some very expressions of paintings with lots of colors and used color a lot. And I think the one thing influenced the other, the music.
Yes.
He said, you know, to me, maybe it was like writing music.
It was like writing music for him, an expression of his feelings, yes?
Yes. Mm-hmm. I think so. And the different colors, you know, they come out, for instance, in Pierolinet, very much so.
Very
Every
much
piece so. Has a different. Different instruments or different
places. Oh, indeed, yeah, it's extraordinarily colorful, yeah.
Yeah.
And of course, there is this the famous orchestral piece, Farben, Colors.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, but there's a little anecdote that you used to tell when we were on the road together doing this show together. Your father actually had an exhibit of his paintings.
Yes.
And he hoped to make some money out of this exhibit, didn't he?
Pardon?
He hoped to make some money by selling paintings, and there was an anonymous buyer, if I recall correctly.
Yes. He bought 6 paintings. My father was so happy, and then found out much later, I think from Weber, was it?
Yes.
That Gustav Mahler had bought them.
So Gustav Mahler bought 6 paintings of your father in order to support him financially. Extraordinary. What I think is important for our viewers, of course, is that they understand that the performances of your father's in those years were heavily contested, of course. This was the revolutionary period with scandal concerts and selling some
people know what scandal concerts are
today anymore. Well, I think there were actually some fist fights, weren't there? In Schoenberg's
period.
Yes.
Mahler had a fist fight, I think, with somebody who was booing after concerts.
Really? Well.
Well, back to the lecture part here. After this personal interlude, I'd like to introduce a music theoretical interlude. Schoenberg was not only probably the most important composer of the 20th century, but also one of the most important theoreticians, mastered music theory like no other composer. And when tonality was over with, done and over with, finished, a closed system, no longer active, Schoenberg was actually able to systematize it, to write a harmonielehre, a treatise of harmony. And this treatise of harmony is dedicated to the memory of Gustav Mahler. The systematization really plays an important role in this next phase of Schoenberg's output, in that he was looking for a way of solidifying that step into pantonality, making sure that one wouldn't regress into tonal idioms. So he designed over a period of several years a very, very complex and very important method to compose pantonally, namely the method of composing with 12 tones that are related only to one another. This is an important definition. We always talk about the 12-tone technique, which is really doesn't capture the method, because 12-tone technique, all music that is based on the chromatic scale is 12-tone music. The important thing is that the method here is with 12 tones that are related only to one another. Take, for instance, Bach's fugue from the Well-Tempered Clavier in B minor from the first book. This theme has all 12 notes of the chromatic scale. Bach, as we know, wrote two volumes of the Well-Tempered Clavier, and in each one of them showed that each key on the keyboard now could be used for chromatic music. And this was a revolution in its own right. It's not a coincidence that with the very last fugue that Bach uses, that Bach writes in the first book, he uses all 12 notes. He is giving the listener the impression now all notes are equal. All notes have been liberated from unequal temperament. So, the method of composing with 12 notes that are related only to one another is a different ballgame altogether. Here we see the so-called 12-tone series to the opera Moses and Aaron. The idea of the 12-tone row is to design an order of intervals so that each pitch of the chromatic scale appears only once. The composer orders those pitches and maintains that order throughout the entire work that he's writing. So for Moses and Aaron, Schoenberg designed this series. Now, in order to make this more interesting, of course, you can play that series backwards. The order has remained the same. We're just hearing, like in a kaleidoscope, we're hearing the same pitches coming from elsewhere. And the same is true that you can mirror these intervals, so that what goes up in the ground, in the prime row, goes down in the inversion, and so forth. So you get, as you can see here, four fundamental rows that are related to one another. They all share the same intervals. This is the musical material, the pitch material that a composer designs to be used in a work that uses the method of composing with 12 tones that are only related to one another. In order to facilitate this, Schoenberg designed little gadgets. For instance, this here, this is for the opera Moses and Aaron, so that he could... I forgot to mention one thing. In order to make the material rich, each of the four ground series can be transposed. So you get altogether 48 different rows. And here in this image, you see a gadget that he designed in order to access the various transpositions of the row. Take a look here. And this is the suite, Opus 25, also a 12-tone work. If I play you the opening, you have, if I play that backwards, we have B-A-C-H. In fact, if you go back to the row of Moses and Aaron, you'll see that he designed the row in such a way that if you played, began here B-A and added these two notes, you also get B-A-C-H. This is an homage to Bach in an opera that is based on the Lutheran translation of the opera, of the Bible, So this is not a coincidence either. To show the virtuosity of Schoenberg's technique, in the menuet that I just played before, you also have, in this measure, you have a transposition of the BACH motif, but embedded in the Tristan chord. So here, Schoenberg is showing us the bookends of tonality, the beginning of tonality with Johann Sebastian Bach, the well-tempered clavier, and the end of tonality with Wagner. Of all students of Schoenberg, Anton Webern applied we'll just call it the 12-tone method, more radically than any of his other students, or even Schoenberg himself. Let's take a look at one of the posthumous published works, a very brief, short piece called Kinderstück. It's designed for children. The 12-tone row that Webern designed for this goes like this. So quite melodic, quite simple, in that it repeats, it has a sequence. Now the sequence, and these two notes. This is a simple series of intervals that we can remember very quickly. Now, listen to what Webern does with this row. That's the first statement of the 12-tone row. We hear the row almost bare. There is rhythm now attached to it, there is expression, but these are individual notes. So we heard all 12 notes. Now, this is a very different approach to the method than what Schoenberg does. Schoenberg uses a 12-tone row as a fundamental, as a basic material with which to compose. For instance, in his later piano concerto, he designs a 12-tone row that goes like this. And when he composes with it, he does. Makes a Vienna waltz out of it. So this is a different approach to composition with 12-tone technique. Let's listen to how the austere style of Webern. So in this type of composition, you can almost hear the row, the basic row, constantly. In the background, it's all as if we're looking through a kaleidoscope. We're seeing different versions of the row. So for Webern, the composition didn't begin after he had designed the row, as it is with Schoenberg, but the composition is actually already begun by designing the row. Once he's attained that row he's looking for, the piece is half composed, to exaggerate. It would have been very interesting to see how music in Europe would have developed had it not been for the incision, the historic incision in 1933, when the Nazis took power and deemed this type of music degenerate. In 1938, Hans-Severus Ziegler did an exhibit in Düsseldorf where he showed all of the so-called degenerate musicians, composers. This was a parallel exhibit to the exhibit of degenerate art from Munich for the visual arts. So all Jewish, black, jazz-oriented Bolshevik was shunned, was forbidden, was deemed degenerate. And so, of course, Schoenberg, being a Jew and an avant-gardist, was deemed degenerate immediately. Webern, who was not a Jew, remained in Austria, and Balck was also not a Jew, also remained in Austria until his death in 1935. Their works still were not performed. Schoenberg, as we know, went to the United States, found a new life in Los Angeles, and in Europe, when the war ended, there had been a vacuum of musical culture. Anything that wasn't völkisch, as the Nazis referred to it, wasn't performed. And a whole generation of musicians became of age without knowing the kind of music we've just been discussing now at length. 12-tone music wasn't known. So when the Nazis were defeated and Germany was down to the ground, the global problem was that Stalinist socialist realism had thrived in the 1930s and early 1940s, while the Western world didn't have an art to compete with it. So as we know today, the Allied forces funneled millions of dollars into the sponsorship of Western art, of abstract art, of art that would counter socialist realism, now with the beginning of the Cold War. They instituted, close to Frankfurt, in Darmstadt, a place called Kranichstein, summer courses for contemporary music, where the goal was to teach these young musicians who would partake in these courses what they had been missing out on for the last 12 years. Among these young composers was a German young man, Karl-Heinz Stockhausen, and he said, after he had seen his hometown of Cologne being bombed, "The cities have been erased. One can begin anew from the bottom up without consideration for ruins and tasteless remains." So for Stockhausen, now 1945 represented ground zero for the arts. You could start something completely new. And this was precisely what the Allied forces wanted. They wanted something new to be on par with the power of socialist realism. So in Darmstadt, Schoenberg was invited to come and give composition classes. He was too ill to travel to Europe. So instead, many of his students or followers were asked to come. Among them, here we see Theodor Adorno, who came from Los Angeles to start teaching. We also saw that Eduard Steuermann, the pianist of the Schoenberg Circle, came from the United States to give classes. Rudolf Kolisch, the great violinist and brother-in-law of Schoenberg, uncle of Nuria Schoenberg-Nono, he came to Darmstadt to teach. So the Schoenberg School was being represented quite well by these representatives of the school. Now, the point of departure for Darmstadt was a application of the 12-tone technique, because this was what had been kept secret and had been refused to be given a public appearance during Nazi period. So this music, especially the music by Webern, seemed to be the kind of music that one could build an entire new aesthetic on. While Schoenberg and Webern had basically only focused on the parameter of pitch with the 12-tone rose, now these composers apply that same technique, the method of composing with 12 tones that are only related to one another, now to all other parameters, so to duration, rhythm, amplitude, dynamics, and tone color sonority. So while a 12-tone row is designed for Schoenberg, dynamics and rhythm, as we heard in the waltz, is very conventional. And this, for 1945, for the generation, seemed too anachronistic. Mind you, you have to take into consideration the abuse of music by the Nazis. Music had been used in all political manifestations, in the newsreels, lists, Les Préludes was used to announce the reports from the front. The over-emotional aspect of music abounded in Nazi Germany. And now in 1945, people had it up to here. They didn't want this over-emotional gesture. So Webern, indeed, that austere approach to composition, seemed to be applicable now. It seemed to be the right kind of aesthetic to develop, a non-emotional music. And if you take a look at one of the very early piano pieces, if not the earliest piano piece that Stockhausen wrote, using the so-called total serialism, the idea of composing only with series on all parameters, you will see what I mean with non-emotional. Try singing to this. Try marching to this. Impossible. This is part of the aesthetic. It is not so easily abused politically. If we take a look at the first, at the second piece from this cycle, there are four pieces by Stockhausen, you also see how the application of musical series on all parameters has consequences that allow a kind of music we haven't heard before. Take, for instance, the first measure. We have three pitches, each of individual duration, to create a so-called aggregate. These are no longer chords in the traditional sense, a C major chord, but these are three individual pitches that make up an aggregate. And each of the pitches has its own length. In a normal context where all would be the same length, that's how it would end. But here we have so the release of the key is just as important as the attack. This makes for novel problems for the listener. We have to listen to not only the beginning of a chord, but also to its specific end. We have to listen to a complexity of dynamics within one aggregate. Take a look at this here. This is a chord that has eight different pitches in different durations, in also different dynamics. Again, we are challenged to listen anew. And as you can see just from the page, each pitch on the page has its own dynamic and its own duration. This is the manifestation of the application of Schoenberg's 12-tone technique to all parameters. Now listen to both Stockhausen pieces, number 3 and number 2. As you can tell, this is music that is completely new. It is something that is unthinkable in any other system, in any sound system. Certainly, in tonality, just completely impossible. This was the new path, and now Boulez, Luigi Nono, embarked on the application of serialism in different manners. Nono was the only one, by the way, who tried to maintain a sense of physiognomy of the intervals, that a minor second is still something expressive, a sighing motive. Whereas Boulez and Stockhausen actually wanted to rid intervals from their physiognomy, from their sedimented spirit over the centuries, and make them something completely pure and new. Nono, who had social interests, political interests, felt that that was throwing the baby out with the bathwater. Music was still designed for human beings, and even though you apply the new serial technique, you are still speaking to the causes of a better world, people. But for Stockhausen and Boulez, the situation was somewhat different. In 1958, the American composer John Cage came to Darmstadt and introduced, by way of his friend and pianist David Tudor, a cycle of piano music called Music of Changes. And if you look at the score here, it's very similar to what we just looked at with Stockhausen. And indeed, this is also music that has been designed by the individual application of pitch, duration, amplitude, and tone color. This was received with great enthusiasm by the Darmstadt gang. But when John Cage explained that his approach to composition was based on the I Ching, on the Book of Changes. This is why the pieces are called the Book of Changes, Music of Changes. it caused basically a catastrophe in Darmstadt, because music that was based on chance operation. In the I Ching, you throw coins in order to give you a chance reading of the Book of Oracles. So Cage used precisely this method to throw coins in order to decide which pitches, which rhythms, which dynamics to apply. The final result of chance-operated composed music to total serialist music was not that different. And this caused a huge upheaval in the Darmstadt group, and it made composers like Boulez and Stockhausen start to integrate chants in their own music. So now to close with the Darmstadt aesthetics, I would just like to mention one other aspect. In his essay, Wie die Zeit vergeht, How Time Passes, Stockhausen describes something that he found in the electronic studio, that when we're talking about different parameters, duration and pitch, for example, it's actually not quite a representation of the real physical world, because there is no sound outside of time. Every sonority takes place in time. If we take a chord like this, it decays over time. And what we hear as a decay, in physical terms, you can show as wave forms that decay. Now, this plays an important role in the next phase of composition by Stockhausen. Let me play you the opening of the piano piece number 9, which is just a few years later, 1961. Before, this is very primitive, you would agree. What happened is now Stockhausen back to the marching rhythm of the Nazis? No. What he's doing is he is transposing a phenomenon into the audible, which one can, in the lab, in the electronic lab, can only see. The decay of a chord like this augmented into slow motion. So this could be the representation of this chord, how it decays. But when we go to the actual piano piece, we hear that same chord down here, slow motion. So you see how Stockhausen is starting to bring together the various parameters to try to reconcile them. When we also then continue in this piece, you see how there is a phase shift. Suddenly we have one pitch anticipate the other three. Instead of these four together, we hear this F sharp before. This represented in physical terms is here, a phase shift. There are other experiments that Stockhausen does on the piano. For instance, reverberation. He's interested in replicating what one can do with electronic means on the piano. Listen to the reverberation of the piano. So this phenomenon is now realized on the piano. Stockhausen is also experimenting with different types of reverberation. He introduces a new technique of half pedaling, where you take a sound and depress the pedal only half, So there is a kind of a dirty after sound. Huh? This is a different type of reverberation. Huh? So these are quite extraordinary innovations. But of course, they go back to Schoenberg as well. Schoenberg explored overtones just as Stockhausen does in the piano piece Opus 11 that I played for you. On the first page, we have this. Here, the loud bass notes give sonority to the overtones, because in the right hand, I'm depressing the chord silently. So when I play the left hand, only the overtones resound. So you see, music history is a give and take. It's not that one composer invents everything, but there are different elements that appear suddenly as something that can be led elsewhere. So to finish this off, this is a representation here of a pure sound, of a sine wave, as it doesn't appear in nature. All sounds that can be determined have a particular shape. On the middle line, you see, for instance, a sound that could represent an oboe sound or a clarinet sound. The particular shape of the wave is repeated. It's regular. On the bottom, you see an irregular sound. This is noise. The moment the waveform doesn't repeat itself, we hear it chaotically as noise. And even this is transposed to the piano piece by Stockhausen. Take a look just at the visuals. You see these irregular waveforms with the little notes on top of the piano, here and here. This, while it sounds decorative, and so on, is meant differently. It's meant as a time noise. These are irregular sounds appearing in chaotic form within a given time frame. So, Zeitgeräusch, time noise. And time noise is where we define the macro time, the overall passing of time, but the lower part, the indeterminate part, is the micro time. And no other work than John Cage's 4 minutes 33 seconds is more indicative of this particular approach to time. This piece constitutes, you will probably all know this piece. Perhaps some of you will have even played it. It is called 4 minutes 33 seconds. And what the performer does, performer comes on stage, sits at his or her instrument, let's say the piano, opens the lid, sits silently for 4 minutes and 33 seconds, closes the lid, and leaves the stage. That is the piece. What most of you who might have heard this piece before, have encountered it, might not know is that the piece is in three movements. So this is how John Cage, here in his smiling fashion, has sublated the sonata form, to use a Hegelian term. He has kept it for posterity. He has liquidated and at the same time suspended it and kept it for posterity. So 4 minutes 33 seconds for some is the end of music. Everything can become music. I see it as one manifestation of the sonata form. Now for the ending of the lecture, and now that we've spent so much time talking about new music and new listening, I'd like to test you and see if all these new aesthetical forms that we've discussed might have an effect on the way you listen to older music. So new music equals new listening. A famous saying goes like this: if you want to listen to the old, you must listen to the new. This is from the Talmud. And I think this is a great motto to end our lecture. We have listened to the new, and now we can listen to the old again. And let's go back to Schumann, with whom we had opened up the lecture recital. We will take a look at two of his pieces from the Fantasiestücke Opus 12. The first one, Des Abends. And just so you know what we're going to be focusing on is this melody. And the accompaniment section. Together, they shape a complex rhythm. The other one, that would generally be enough already for us to be interested in listening. Well, Schumann introduces a little later another voice which appears slightly off in pulse. So let me play you the opening of that page. Now, so there's a shifting of pulse. This is something the young Schumann does in almost every work. He's preoccupied with this ambivalence, ambiguity of rhythm. And we find this as well in the second piece of the Fantasiestücke, in Aufschwung. I'll play you just the opening so you know what we're talking about. And in the second section, this is where we'll focus on a detail which is overplayed by most pianists, I might add. It's something that is indeed not easy to represent musically. Take a look at these, at the voice leading of the right hand. We have, and two measures later. Now, the tenor voice. Does the same thing, except in a different rhythm. So we have. And this all brought into with triplet motion. If we go back, now that you've heard Stockhausen, that's a phase shift. Schumann already composed a phase shift. And in one of the most daring moments of this piece, Schumann does something that we've already encountered with Schoenberg. Let me play you this section here, again, in the way the composer did not write it. What did I do wrong? I played the left hand far too loudly. He writes specifically piano. Only the right hand has crescendi and constant crescendi until it falls back to piano. And in the next page, there is yet again, sorry, next page, yet again, a big crescendo in the right hand, not in the left, and suddenly in the left hand, the piano explodes in the bass as well. So listen to this, just this part. This is akin to what Schoenberg did in the piano piece number 3. And with that, I will finish off the lecture part with the two Schumann works and then move back to the second conversation with Nuria Schoenberg-Nono.
one point, Kaminsky wanted my father to come and teach at the Bauhaus in Germany. And my father's very good friend, saying exactly what she was. She was a very good friend his whole life, because then she was married to Mahler.
You're speaking about Alma Mahler.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, Alma Mahler. She was, she had her salon, and that's how my father was introduced to Mahler, and Mahler was, although he, we had big discussions and everything. He said, I don't understand your music, but we are young.
So you are right. If I can just interject for a moment, Alma Mahler was actually a student of your father's brother-in-law, Alexander Zemlinsky. Yeah. So that's how they actually knew each other long before.
They were both young students studying with Zemlinsky.
After your father's death and your first trip to, or one of the first trips to Europe with your mother for the performance of Moses and Aaron in Hamburg for that Schellchen did, this is where you met your future husband.
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about this?
Yeah, it's a nice story.
It's a great story for our viewers and listeners. When you refer to Gigi, you're referring to your husband, Luigi Nono. of course, insiders know, but so this is, Gigi is Luigi Nono.
No, this was such a big occasion. The first performance.
Of Moses and Aaron, yeah.
And so she decided to take me with her
to Hamburg, yeah.
To Hamburg. This was 1954, mm-hmm. So I was 22.
So your father had passed away 3 years prior, yeah?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And we got there, and my mother was, well, she wasn't so old, you know, you all see people are older than they are.
It happens to all of us, yes.
Yeah, you know, but she was young herself, so. But so we went there, and then everything was wonderful. The people were so nice to us, and everything, and the performance was fantastic. And afterwards, there was a big dinner reception, and there were all the important people from the radio and from music and so on. And we all sat at a long table, and Mother was way at the other end. And I was just about practically across from this very handsome Italian
composer, yeah.
Composer who had been presented to my mother. He wanted to be a video of my children, not me, it was the next to her that was a picture of him. Mm-hmm. And, and everything. And then we met him in Rome. No, I have to go back. So I have to go back to the dinner. After the concert, there was this dinner.
Yeah.
Where all the people part in the performance and the people from the radio, doctor, all these people sitting at this long table. And one end was mother and the doctor and so on. Yeah? And at the other end was Luigi Nono across from me. Not exactly across the table. And he started asking me questions.
About?
About Los Angeles. Oh. Or about the strikes that were going on in Detroit.
Oh, so he was politically already extremely interested.
Yeah, like he was reading the Unità, which was a communist newspaper. They knew much more than I. About what was going on in the strikes in Detroit. So what about the strikes in Detroit? How is that going? But he kept asking me questions, and his eyes were so, they were so enchanting. There was something about these eyes that I couldn't not answer. And at one point, he asked me something about the American government. And we were speaking German to each other, which was neither mine nor his first language. And so at one point, I wanted to say, well, the government does something. I couldn't think of the German word for government. And I was so eager to answer him, you know, it was urgent.
Yeah.
You know, that's the right word. I just feel that I had to tell him that. And I still get red in the face when I think of what I did, because I screamed across the whole table, as 20 people between me and my mother. Mother, how do you say government in German? And she very cool. She was like, thank you. Yeah. You know, and then she taught her.
Wow, so that, you got off to an
answer him. But I knew at that point, I think that was when I decided that was who I was going to spend the rest of my life.
Really? The magic word government did it to you, yes?
Yeah.
When you and Gigi would spend the summers in Darmstadt,
yeah.
There are these wonderful photographs of you on the balcony of your uncle's apartment, Rudolf Polish. So what, since the consequences of your father's compositional techniques, whether it be pantonality or the 12-tone method, were so important for the younger generation. I mean, not only your husband, but also Karlheinz Stockhaus and Pierre Boulez. This was sort of the period, as at least we who didn't live it, but we read about it, where all the innovations of your father and of his students were introduced to a young generation that had not known about this because of Nazi cultural politics.
Yeah.
So this must have been an extraordinary time period for you also to meet all these people. What was the rapport like between your husband and Stockhaus and Boulez? They were all young men striving for new art, yeah?
Well, when they were young, they were all so excited about learning all these new things, and the people who were teaching them were mostly people who lived in pre-Nazi, pre-fascism.
Yeah.
And had, you know, had the experience of this kind of music and these works, and the experience, unfortunately, of them being forbidden.
So
this was an experience, it was a unique experience of these people meeting young people who had grown up with very classical conservatory kind of learning, and what who wanted to do more. They wanted to know more about this because it was something that was against that period, and a lot of that is it's almost like a political thing too, I guess.
Indeed, it was very political.
But you also wanted something modern.
Mm-hmm.
And there were droves of people who came from Poland, mostly Poland.
Well, Penderecki was one of the young composers who came, right, to Darmstadt. Penderecki was one of the composers who came.
But there were a lot of them. And they wanted to write modern music. Because
so,
it wasn't really so easy to do 12-tone composition.
No, of course not, yeah.
And what happened was that a lot of people came there, young composers from different countries for living. Remember who were looking for a formula for writing modern music. You know, if I use this, or it's just you just make up a row, you can make this one, you can make that one.
It's,
and
yeah.
It's right, and it's all done, and you just follow that, and you listen to the music.
Yeah.
And that is not what it's all about.
Yeah. What I've read is actually quite fascinating, is that for the experienced composers already in Darmstadt. I mean, I'm speaking of Stockhausen, your husband, and Boulez. Webern turned out to be the model because it seemed to be less emotionally occupied for them.
Yeah.
After the Nazis had abused music so much and used it for their purposes, all kind of super emotional music was shunned by the younger generation. So when John Cage came to Darmstadt, what was that like?
Well, it was fantastic because his friend, David Tudor got up on the stage and sat on the chair and didn't do anything for a while, and then it was over, you know. And that was terrific, because if you even use that 12-tone stuff, and even if you just followed it, you know, the rhythm and the way, it was still a lot of work. But here, you could do anything you wanted to, no matter what you did or didn't do.
What is curious, of course, is that John Cage was really the only one of the Darmstadt generation who knew your father and had studied with him. So what did your father think of John Cage?
He said he's not a good composer, but he's an inventor.
Uh-huh. Well, there's a tongue-in-cheek thing that John Cage would always say when he was asked why he became a composer. He said, because I promised it to Schoenberg. Because your father apparently taught him for free.
Yeah, I think so.
And and said to him, look, I'm going to teach you for free, but you have to promise to dedicate your life to music.
And he did. He wrote quartets and things in those days.
Yeah.
And then he came. The only thing I remember, you know, because I was too, I remember that when I was a little older, that Cage came to visit my father, and he showed him the prepared piano.
Oh, yeah, because that was, of course, in the late 40s he was doing that.
Yeah. And he stuck little pieces of paper in the piano. And then Daddy came to, after he left, my father came to lunch and this, and he told, you know, he told Mother, and he said, well, yeah, you know, he's not a composer, but he's an inventor.
Yeah.
I remember that. I remember first.
That's fascinating. So your father was witness to Cage's invention of the prepared piano, which is now, of course, among the material that the composers use. Yeah.
Yeah.
One composer, of course, who we should mention, we haven't mentioned him yet, but of course he was a student of your husband's, was Helmut Lachenmann, who has created an entire universe of new sounds that can be produced on instruments, what he refers to as musique concrète instrumentale. And so I think what's wonderful to see is sort of this sequel of generations who build on what your father started. And there's sort of a lineage, really, that goes all the way to Helmut Lachenmann's
work. It's interesting, the people who were just copying what he did or were doing anything mechanically, you know, disappeared. But the people who understood what he was doing, or they had the same music, they were able to be with their own personality and their own inventiveness.
Now, one last thing I'd like to talk about, since it's something that is rarely spoken about, was your father's influence on interpretation, on the performance of traditional works. I mean, if one understands that the performance tradition in Vienna around turn of the century was what Mahler referred to as Schlamperei, that this was not something that one should build one's reputation on, the so-called tradition. And your father had very clear ideas about performance, about how Beethoven's string quartet should be performed, for instance. Mm-hmm. And if I don't know if it's a legend or if it's true, but apparently Rudolf Kohler's decision to perform the metronome markings of Beethoven the way that they are written in the score goes back to an experience with your father. Is that right?
That could be, because my father encouraged him to be a student when he was young, and they have those concerts in the Philharmonic of Berlin.
Yes.
And my father encouraged me to form a quartet.
Ah, so even the formation of the quartet was your father's.
Mm-hmm. So he must have had a great deal of influence on some other fellow.
Well, there's this famous story that your father apparently said to Rudolf Kohlisch, said, look, you really need to play the Opus 95 string quartet by Beethoven in the metronome marking that's written, because that's the way the character of the music is. Mm-hmm. And this was not done in those days. Mm-hmm. Beethoven's metronome markings were not taken seriously by most musicians. I mean, there were some exceptions, Toscanini, for example. Yeah? Mm-hmm. And then, of course, your uncle then came out in the 1940s with a article, yes, Tempo and Character in Beethoven's Music. What's also interesting to me is that your father apparently suggested to your uncle that they should play from memory.
Yeah.
I mean, to me, it's still unthinkable that the lyric suite of Berg was premiered by memory. They played this from memory, the premiere of the work. But what I think, just for our viewers and listeners, what's an important aspect to keep in mind is that your father not only introduced completely new ways of composing, but ways of thinking about music. That music was made up of different segments. Not everything was emotion. There were also musical thoughts. Yeah.
And he speaks of musical thought.
And this he learned from the tradition. This is to me one of the most extraordinary aspects of his pedagogical approach, was that he didn't teach himself. He didn't teach what he thought one should do as a composer, but he taught the tradition, and he helped students understand the tradition by analyzing the work. And thus, performance traditions were questioned just the way your father questioned traditional analysis of works. So, thank you very, very much, Nuria, for sharing this.
It's always a pleasure to talk with you.
Yes.
And, thank you for having me.